Black Lives Matter conversation.
When growing up in Jamaica, you knew that there was a bit of racism around, but I only heard about things like that. I never experienced it in Jamaica. Perhaps just because I didn't go to places where I could experience racism.
Well, I grew up in a very multicultural, diverse London with all sorts of colours, black, white, Asian. Everyone was a melting pot. And I noticed as soon as I walked into the world of cricket, comments started.
I know about a particular story of a gentleman that lived on the road that I grew up. His name was Evan Blake. He went to a hotel downtown Kingston that only expats and white Jamaicans went to. And he decided that he was going to break the law, I suppose, as far as they were concerned. He went down there to the swimming pool, jumped in, and of course everyone jumped out. The people responsible for the hotel, they called the police. And when the police came, they escorted him out of the property and they drained the pool before a white person got back in it.
I had comments about where I grew up and that the fact that I had a long name, maybe my mum didn't know who my dads were, you know, about my hair, about body parts, especially the derriere, shall we say, about the food I ate and that it sort of stank. You know, it was just constant, did I wash my skin? Everyone in your area gets stabbed. You know, all these sort of things were drip feed constantly. It was really difficult for me as a kid because I put on this sort of bravado, and I think my personality's developed actually to an extent to be jovial and bat it off. I never had the confidence to turn around and tell people to really get lost and deal with it. I took it on internally, and I think it wore away my confidence for a lot of my early years.
I went to Australia my very first tour, 75, 76, and I never experienced any racism on the cricket field. But I heard comments, you know, you're feeling down by the boundary. I was never going to be in the slips. I was never going to be in the covers. So I'm down at fine leg or third man. And you hear some comments being passed. But again, at that stage, I just thought, these people are sick.
I've been in team environments. Dealing constantly with people referring to your lot.
And then, of course, I came to England in 76 and it started again. But again, I just told myself, and I think most of the team just brushed it off. And I told myself personally, Mikey, you're here for the summer. You're going back home in September.
When things would happen, like Barack Obama becoming president in the US, having a paper thrown down in front of my face and saying, your lot must be happy. Look, it's the constant drip drip was tough. And I'm not surprised that people who come into the environment don't want to deal with that. I question myself why I stayed sometimes so long. I love the game. I think it has so much more to offer, but it can be really difficult dealing with. That day in, day out.
And that was my attitude. Once no one actually touched me physically, I just said to myself, that's their problem, not my problem. I'm going home in September.
Making your debut for your country is an incredible experience. I remember getting my cap from Charlotte Edwards out in Chennai. We're in India. You know, it's pretty special. I think anyone making their debut is special. But I even remember the moment when a lady called Imogen said, look, I think you might be the first black person to play for England. I said, no, it can't be, because I would assume by now, you know, we're into late 2007, there must by now have been another, and there wasn't. And I knew through playing that there hadn't been. You know, you go through the years and you look around, you go into every room and you don't see any, but it to actually hit you that you're the first. I felt a mixture of emotions. I felt proud on one hand, but also a bit embarrassed, uncomfortable, and it took me a long time to really feel comfortable owning that, because I wanted there to be more. I didn't want to be the only one, and it's something that I still feel a little bit plagued by now.
Andy's out, LBW on the score. There's a danger man holding.
1976 was when Tony Gregg made that comment on BBC about making the West Indies grovel. I actually saw it live.
The West Indians, these guys, if they get on top, they're magnificent cricketers. But if they're down,
they grovel. And I intend, with the help of Clancy and a few others, to make them grovel.
It was the word grovel that caused the problems. Tony Gregg, with a South African background, and those days, of course, apartheid was strong, middle of apartheid era, and his South African background using that word against a team that was mainly black, it just made everybody stand up and think, is this man trying to be racist? Is he saying that we little black boys, he's gonna just put his foot on us and we're gonna be groveling? Obviously, as time went on, I discovered that Tony Gregg was not racist. And I think a lot of the guys after that realized he wasn't racist. It was just a matter of him using that particular word and the connotations around the word grovel. And that made us really get fired up whenever he came to the crease. As far as bowlers in particular, nah, we were ready. And a lot of the English batsmen didn't like batting with Tony Gregg when he was at the crease. The Black West Series, I think, was 1984. That was my third tour here to England. And I can understand totally why the West Indians call it Blackwash. What came home to me, though, when I started to tour England more regularly and get to meet the West Indians who lived here and get to understand exactly what they went through in this country, was what it meant to them for us to win. And I can totally understand them saying, what is this whitewash thing? Why has everything good got to be white? We're going to call this blackwash. And I was happy that they could identify with something and call it whatever they want.
And that's out, and it's LBW, and it's all over. Holding takes the wicket. Overcome the crowd.
And that note put a different perspective on the entire proceedings. And having that knowledge, you say to yourself, no, if I can change this, if I don't have to put up with this, if I am going to even have to answer back, I will.
The team as constituted now is not the team of the MCC. It is the team of the anti-apartheid movement.
When the Dolabella incident took place and the cancelling of tours and all that, and Prime Minister of South Africa Foster made those comments, you have to remember that was when I was in my youth. And that I am there thinking to myself, what is this all about? Why, you know, Dolabella almost looks white to me. But that is the way white supremacists think. If you have an ounce of anything but white in you, you're below them. So, you know, that's him. That's people that have problems. And I thought to myself, okay, that's his view. That's why South Africa is the way it is. I didn't expect it to get to the point at which it did get. But at the same time, I'm happy that it did get to that where people decide they were not going to have sporting contact with South Africa. Maybe that's how your leader is going to behave. Why should we be getting involved with you?
What's the blood money like in South Africa? You're going to get a nice new car out of this, Mr. Gadding. You're going to get a yacht out of this, a second home, Mr. Yadding. Gonna get lots of nice skirts for the rest of your life on the backs of the blacks of South Africa. You're gonna get a lot of money out of this, Mr. Gatlin.
And as for the rebel tours later on, obviously I didn't go on any. I was never ever going to support the apartheid regime. I fell out with a lot of the guys who did go. I made some very caustic remarks in regards to them at the time. Looking back now, perhaps I could have been a little bit more diplomatic, but that's not me. I tell you exactly how I think, exactly how I feel. And there's absolutely no way I would have gone to South Africa under the apartheid regime. I see that as supporting South Africa, supporting the apartheid regime. People may say, oh, we tried to go down there and make changes. No, I don't see that way at all. Whether you're black, white, pink, green, if you are going to South Africa during the apartheid regime, you are supporting the apartheid regime. And that's just my outlook. And there's no way I was going to support it.
I can still remember the moment I found out about George Floyd. I was lying in bed and turned my phone on. I remember it was the first thing that came up in my story, the video of George Floyd. It was like a short version, and I clicked on and clicked off because the first thing you heard was the words, "I can't breathe."
People could see life slowly ebbing out of the man, and people could see the look on the police officer's face and the look on the faces of the other police officers that were around, as if they did not care If this man dies, it's just another black man that we have killed.
I watched the whole thing. I watched the 8 minutes and I burst into tears. The pain I felt, it felt like a valve popped, because we know for how long that these inequalities, these injustices have taken place, not just in the US, it happens here. And I remember watching it and just being, feeling like I was torn apart. I actually swore I never swear on my, or rarely swear on my Instagram, and I wrote the words, "Is anyone else fed up watching black people get murdered?"
I think technology has caught up with the races in America. This thing has been going on for decades, for a very, very long time. But people were getting away with it because they were not being filmed, they were not being caught, and now technology has caught up with them and people are actually seeing it.
You can't help but not see it, and it was just frustrating that people are not seeing what's going on. I felt broken. I would say it was 2 weeks of anger, of pain, of speaking to lots of different people who are just frustrated and fed up with the state of our world, and also being gaslighted and told these issues don't exist. They do exist. I knew I had to get involved. I went to 3 protests. There's a virus that's been part of our society for well over 400 years and is continuing to push this oppression.
Years ago, protests, even when Martin Luther King was marching, you'd have predominantly black faces and a few white faces. This time around, a lot of blacks, but also a lot of white people are involved in these protests. And that is the difference. What they saw was disgusting, and people just thought to themselves, enough is enough.
I think it's one of the most empowering experiences to be around a diverse community and everybody supporting and knowing that we need to really uncover this. This needs to be dealt with. We cannot have it being acceptable that someone dies and people are being killed day in, day out by the people that are meant to be protecting you.
Racism is taught. No one is born a racist. But the environment in which you grow, the society in which you live, encourages and teaches racism. Everybody has heard about this lady in the park with her dog, who was asked by a black man in America to put her dog on a leash, which was the law, or which is the law. And she threatened this black man with her whiteness, saying that she was going to call the police and tell the police that there's a black man threatening her. If the society in which she was living did not empower her or to get her to think that she had that power of being white and being able to call the police on a black man, she would not have done it. It's just a reaction. It's an automatic reaction because of the society in which she lives. And that's what I'm talking about, teaching people. If you don't educate people, they'll keep on growing up in that sort of society and you'll not get meaningful change.
I think we have to be honest. I think we're starting to have those conversations now. Our world of sport, for example, people say there aren't any inequalities, but you start to look around, people in position of power, statistics have come out that there are almost 0 black people in any boards in our governing bodies. What does that say? And then you look at the grassroots level, and in a lot of the sports like ours, I mean the world of cricket, rugby, golf, tennis, you name it, there are no opportunities for people coming through. There are structural problems. You know, unless you connect and understand what it feels like to be on the side of limited power in the world and to not be getting access to opportunities, to know that you put in a CV and your name shows your ethnicity and you are significantly less likely to be hired, you're significantly more likely to be stopped and searched. Until people in power start to understand and feel what it feels like to be oppressed, we won't progress. I think it can't be a black person's problem, I'm putting that in inverted commas, it's got to be everyone's problem. We've got to want a society that is representative and supports people from different backgrounds. So for me, that's where it's got to be. Honest conversations, opportunities, people in positions of power, and we can change the landscape.
everyone is recognizing it. Everyone is now coming alive and seeing the difference in treatment of people. And we're all human beings. So I hope that people will recognize that this Black Lives Movement is not trying to get black people above white people or above anyone else. It's about all about equality. And when you say to somebody, Black Lives Matter, and they tell you all lives matter or white lives matter, please, we black people know white lives matter. I don't think you know that black lives matter. So don't shout back at us about all lives matter. It is obvious, the evidence is clearly there, that white lives matter. We want black lives to matter now. Simple as that.